Before we begin our service, let me offer just a quick announcement. This will be the last Sunday I'll be with you until I return from my sabbatical. So it's a joy to share this occasion with you. And I certainly am grateful to you and to the parish, especially our staff and our wardens, for allowing me this time of rest and refreshment. And already I eagerly await returning to you on August the 1st, when we gather together for a service of Holy Eucharist on that Sunday. So in the meantime, you'll be in my prayers, and I would request that you hold me in your prayers as well. Now let's pause for just a moment, and then we'll begin our service for the Feast of Pentecost. Thanks so much for being a part of our community. Alleluia, Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, On this day, you open the way of eternal life to every race and nation by the promised gift of your Holy Spirit. Shed abroad this gift throughout the world by the preaching of the gospel, that it may reach to the ends of the earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. When the day of Pentecost had come, the disciples were all together in one place. And suddenly, from heaven, there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them the ability. Now there were devoted Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem, and at this sound the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galilean? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs. In our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power." All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and to listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. A reading from the Gospel of St. John. Jesus said to his disciples, "When the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who comes from the Father, he will testify on my behalf. You also are to testify, because you have been with me from the beginning. I did not say these things to you from the beginning, because I was with you, but now I am going to him who sent me. Yet none of you ask me, 'Where are you going?' But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your hearts. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away, for if I do not go away, the Advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will prove the world wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because they do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father and you will see me no longer. About judgment, because the ruler of this world has been condemned. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth, for he will not speak on his own, but will speak whatever he hears, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. For this reason, I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Today we celebrate the Feast of Pentecost. And the Pentecost is the day on which we celebrate the arrival of the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is probably the least understood and the most mysterious aspect of God's Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. There may be moments in our lives where we feel like we get some particular insight into the Holy Spirit or to the Father or the Son. And maybe those are fleeting and far between, but it's nice when we feel like we have some handle on the aspect of the Holy Spirit. I can remember a day in particular. This was years ago. My family and I took a trip to the Grand Canyon, and we love to hike and see the sights. It is absolutely as grand as the name implies. And we decided one day that we would hike down to the bottom of the canyon on the Bright Angel Trail. So we set out early in the morning. It was a beautiful day, not a cloud in the sky, no humidity in the air. It was really wonderful as we started to make our way further and further and further into the canyon. And it occurred to us, occurred to me after about an hour of hiking, that that really every step into the canyon that I took probably represented about three steps out of the canyon I would have to take later in the day. When we got to about midday, we realized there was no way we were going to make it all the way down to the bottom of the canyon, and that maybe we should stop, have our picnic lunch, rest for a while, then make our way back up. The whole time heading into the canyon, I'd been concerned about the boys, and would they have the stamina to make it back up out of the canyon? When we turned around and we started back up the canyon on the Bright Angel Trail, I discovered real quick-like it wasn't the boys I needed to be worried about. I think we had only come about a quarter of a mile back up the canyon when I realized I was having the hardest time of anybody with our hike. My heart started to race, my lungs had a hard time holding on to the breath. To my breath. My legs got heavier and heavier. I required more and more stops. My shirt was wringing wet. I was a mess. And I had to stop and rest, and I'd walk a few more steps and stop and rest. I was really exhausted and realized it was going to take me quite a while to get out of this canyon. As I tried to move forward, I remembered a sermon that John Claypool, the rector at St. Luke's in Birmingham, Alabama, had preached years ago. He told the story of a young boy who was a distance runner who had come close to the end of finishing a race, and as he came closer to the end of the race, he became more and more fatigued, and he wondered whether he could finish the race, and then he decided perhaps maybe he'd just quit. Before he quit, he decided maybe he'd offer a little prayer. He said he'd make a deal with God. He said, if you'll pick him up, I'll put him down, meaning his stride. So I thought, well, if that worked for the little boy who finished the race, maybe I should just, I'd pray that prayer and maybe it'd help me out of the canyon. So I started to pray that little prayer, you know, Lord, if you'll pick him up, I'll put him down. And I began to repeat that just to myself as I was taking steps, and found out that, sure enough, I was able to regain enough strength and continue on my way. I'm embarrassed to say how long it took me to get out of the Grand Canyon and what condition I was in when I finally got to the top and collapsed into our hotel room's bed. But I had made it. I think about that story and I think about God's presence coming alongside of me, and that gave me some particular insight into the Holy Spirit. Most typically, I think, we remember the Holy Spirit and the Holy Spirit's activity in our lives, and we think about the Holy Spirit as the advocate or the comforter. And certainly the Holy Spirit is a comfort to us. Certainly the Holy Spirit is an advocate for us. But if you look at the Greek, that word paraclete in the Greek really translates most accurately into English as one who comes alongside of us. That's really what the Holy Spirit does, comes alongside of us. I think about the disciples as they experience the Holy Spirit for the first time. They are cloistered away in fear in that upper room. They wonder what the future holds. They're terrified. They're afraid of their own shadows. And so into that fearful environment, the Holy Spirit comes. From the lesson in Acts, we hear with a sound like the rushing wind, like thunder, and tongues of fire alight on the disciples' heads. They become encouraged. They become emboldened. They become courageous. We hear from that story that Peter, who just 50 days prior to this incident denies Jesus three times, he is so consumed by the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit that he bursts out into the street and he begins to proclaim the gospel with such power and such conviction that 3,000 people are baptized. It's a remarkable event. Now think about what happened in the lives of the disciples that day 2,000 years ago, and I think the Holy Spirit didn't come to comfort them. It didn't come as their advocate. The Holy Spirit came alongside of them and encouraged them, emboldened them, gave them not just a vision for the future, but gave them a will to act in the future. It was the Holy Spirit that moved the disciples to burst forth from that room with courage and with power and conviction and begin to spread the good news far and wide. Here we are gathered in this room. And through the power and the mystery of God, I think the Holy Spirit comes to us in the same way. Maybe not as dramatic. I don't think we expect to hear wind rushing through our nave like thunder, and I don't think we expect to see tongues of fire resting on anybody on this particular day, but that notwithstanding, we are given strength, we're given courage, we're given the power to move into the future with courage and with conviction. It becomes our privilege, our desire to move out into the world and spread the power of the gospel and the good news. I think through the power of the Holy Spirit, God comes alongside us and doesn't just provide us with a vision for the future, but gives us the power to act in the future. This last Pentecost, we were still deep in the life of a pandemic. And here we are, this Pentecost, beginning to see perhaps and hopefully the end of the pandemic. And what does that mean for the future? What does that mean for the world and for our lives in the next few months or few years? I don't know that we can answer that question today, but what we can know, what we can be assured of, is that the Holy Spirit comes alongside us and gives us not just a vision for the future, but gives us the courage to act on behalf of God and God's people.
Thank you. So who else was jealous the first time you heard the story of the fires of Pentecost? A small group of Christians getting together with a few snacks to discuss how awkward they feel at work when someone asks them if they're one of those followers of Jesus Christ. And then out of the blue, tongues of flame descend on them, sent by the good Lord himself. And suddenly they have command of several languages, and their fear of public speaking has been scorched into ashes by these tongues of fire. If that's what a small group for biblical studies can do, where do I sign up? Hey, churches are big and their buildings don't move, and sometimes Sunday morning service can feel like getting up and going to work. You know, you get up early, you got to get the family dressed, get everybody moving, drive to the service, find a parking spot, and then maybe you end up eating out after church, and by the time you're home, it's been 4 or 5 hours. And tell me, what did you learn? How did the Word of God speak to you? What was your personal takeaway? It's easy to get caught up in the ceremony of church and yet miss a connection to Jesus Christ. I know, I've been there, I've helped raise a small family and while also owning a small business, and often got home from Sunday service exhausted. It can happen, you know, it's being involved with a small group was my opportunity, though, to delve into a personal relationship with the risen Savior with a few folks that were also raising a family and struggling with the hectic pace of life. Over the years, the different groups I've been a part of have really helped me bridge that gap between the ceremony of a church service to a personal connection with Jesus. When I'm with two or three others and we have the time to really parse a biblical passage or a quote from a noted Christian author or speaker, you know, that really provides me an opportunity to look for that small spark of insight, courtesy of the Holy Spirit. Leading a small group means I get to play a critical part in what makes our church congregation a vibrant community of believers. Now, you may not leave my small group speaking Aramaic fluently, but we will have opened the door to the possibility of that personal connection that so many of us desire.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Bless all those whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them to the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled. And we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us bring to God all of our petitions and thanksgivings using the words which Christ himself has taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with you this day and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.